Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 20th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022, which today we are conducting in a hybrid format. Today we have apologies from Fiona Hislop, MSP. At agenda item 1, we have consideration of whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Item 3 is consideration of the evidence we will hear today. And item 4 is further consideration of the approach the committee will take to the future inquiry into ferry services. Do we agree to take these items in private? That is agreed. Thank you very much. Items 3 and 4 will be taken in private. Our next agenda item is an evidence session in relation to our ongoing inquiry into the role of local government and its cross-sectoral partners in financing and delivering a Net Zero Scotland. I refer members to the clerks and the Spice Papers for this item. Today we are going to hear from an expert panel on how house building can contribute towards net zero goals. I welcome three panellists this morning who are joining us in the committee room. Fiona Kell, Director of Policy, Homes for Scotland. Tom Norris, Managing Director, Places for People Scotland. And Niall Robertson, Director, Building Consultancy, Jones Lang LaSalle. Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for joining the committee this morning. It's a pleasure to have you here. We've allocated up to about 75 minutes for this session, and we will begin with questions. The first question I have relates to the heat in buildings targets set out in the Scottish Government's policy. Fiona, in the written submission provided by Homes for Scotland, you say the following: there is a very real chance that the legislation around much of the net zero targets has been set well before the skills are developed, and that this could lead to a period of economic stagnation. These concerns have been raised in many other sessions that the committee has had in this area. We've heard about local authorities, the lack of resourcing, the challenges faced in the planning departments, as well as the limited availability of teams available to retrofit and decarbonise heat in buildings. So I'd like to ask each of you, perhaps I could go with Fiona, then Tom, then Niall. What do you see as the major resource and skills constraints in this area in terms of delivering the targets for heat in buildings? And can I ask you, given those challenges, do you think those 2030 targets are realistic and can be achieved? So Fiona, if I can start with you, please.
Okay, good morning. Thanks for inviting us to attend this morning. I think really to start, it's worth saying that I think the home building industry as a whole understands, respects and supports the aim. And we are committed to achieving what is practicable at the earliest opportunity. And I think it's important that we emphasise that. You know, we're not starting from a standing start, and the industry has already made great strides. But you're right in saying that there are significant concerns that we feel. The way that I would describe it is building the house at the end of it is almost the last and easiest part of the jigsaw. And it's ensuring that the rest of the components of the system are in place to allow the physical house to be built at the end of it. So from our point of view, we think there's significant issues around grid capacity, around the supply chain, skills and labour, as you've touched on. I think it's also something around the wider societal impacts and customer affordability and readiness to be able to address all of this. In addition then to the skills that we touched on, yes, there are technical skills issued or technical skills required, upskilling in terms of moving from gas boiler installation to heat pump installation, for example. But also I think it's really important that we emphasise the skills in local authorities. We're really concerned that the requirements in terms of enhanced understanding of these issues that we required of both planning and building control departments, and we know they are already under significant pressure. So for us, there is a concern that may form a significant blockage in the system if we haven't got those skills addressed. So that sort of in general is our starting point. Committed to it, understand why, trying everything to get there, but recognising that it's part of a very complex and interconnected system.
Thanks very much, Fiona. Very helpful overview. You've touched on a number of issues we'll come back to. Tom, I wonder if I could address the same question to you, please.
Sure. Thank you very much for the invite to come and talk to you today. Places for People Scotland is an affordable social rent housing association. We're part of a much larger UK group, but in Scotland we're very much focused on social rent. And I think I'd draw out just what Fiona said there about this whole thing around people and customers. And I think for us, the absolute key as we go forward with all of these changes, moving to net zero and all of the other kind of legislative things that we're required to do, is we mustn't forget that end customer. You know, I've got around 10,000 customers in Scotland, and it's hard out there, as we all know. But, you know, my teams are seeing it on the coalface every single day. And I think that as we move forward, we have to be so careful that we don't inadvertently put customers' bills up even more than they already are and push people into fuel poverty. So our balance as a non-for-profit entity is to make sure that we move forward gently when appropriate, that we're innovative when appropriate, and that we don't end up using any of our customers effectively as guinea pigs to test things out. We've got to make sure that we do two things, that we allow them to affordably heat their homes and that we decarbonise at the same time. It sounds easy when I say it like that, but as we all know, that's not the case. So parking that point about all of our customers, and you know, that's at our heart. I think the challenges that we've got around skills, they're everywhere across the sector at the moment. So it's not just in this area. You know, employing people, particularly in trades, is challenging. And that flows through into, you know, more newer technologies, if you like. And I think that it's a bit chicken and egg. As we see more technology come online, we see more heat pumps, we'll then see more people qualified and able to repair those. But it is a challenge, as we're retrofitting in particular, to make sure that we've got the skills in our organisation, or we've got the contractors available who can support everything that we need to do to make sure that we don't just retrofit something, but it's going to work in the long term and it's sustainable, again, for our customers and affordable. And I think that challenge there about how we ensure that the particularly on retrofit, I've come to new build in a moment, but particularly on retrofit, that we recognise that the disruption to people's lives is pretty significant, particularly on the older properties. If you drew a circle around where we are right now, we've got 2,000 properties in a mile's radius of here. Now, you'll all know this area, so you'll know we've got some really old stock. It's really challenging to deal with. We've also got some newer stuff that's somewhat easier. But either way, when we do start retrofitting things, there is disruption. And dependent on the stock type, it can be relatively significant for our customers. So we have to keep that in mind at the same time. So I think that, ever the optimist, with the right cross-sector, with the right joined-up approach, I think it's achievable for us to decarbonise in the way the government are looking for us to do. There needs to be a more joining up, I think. We find that there are often different bits of legislation that push against each other that make it hard for us to do what's effectively the right thing that we all agree with. If you just take EASH2 and our decarbonisation things, there's a rub there that we're finding right at the moment. So I think a more joined up approach, more industry collaboration, and us really working together to deliver those targets, I think is the way to do it. There's more work to be done, without question.
Thanks very much, Tom. I'd like to come back to you. You mentioned joint working. I'd like to come back to you on the question of finance, how this is all financed, because we've heard about non-financial challenges. There are certainly a number of them, but obviously one of the major challenges is also going to be the question of how this is going to be financed. Niall, if I could bring you in the first question and then maybe later on ask you about financing as well.
Sorry, just to say, I pronounced my name Neil.
Neil, sorry.
Scottish pronunciation. So thanks very much for inviting me along today. Very much appreciated. Just to introduce myself, I'm a chartered building surveyor and I work in commercial property. So the domestic sector isn't really my area of expertise per se. But I think the points that are raised, you know, apply across the board. Yeah. There are, you know, there's since the pandemic, you know, almost came to an end and we're starting to get back to normal, there's been a huge demand for professional services, such as RICS members and engineers, all these specialities. So in commercial property, there's a real demand for retrofit at the moment. We are seeing a huge demand from our clients for more sustainable buildings as they embrace ESG. There are I think 200,000 or over 200,000 non-domestic buildings in Scotland. So you can see the scale of the challenge involved there. Kind of moving on to skills, there are, you know, I think it's been recognised, I agree with everything that's been said regarding skills shortage. You know, an engineer, a plumber, you know, works in both domestic and non-domestic, so the challenges exist across the sector. I understand that RICS are working closely with the Scottish Government and Skills Development Scotland to try and address some of these skill shortages.
Thanks very much, Neil. Really great, actually, to have a different perspective from each panellist. I would like to bring you in a bit later, Neil, about on the commercial side. Will it over time have an impact on the value of the building if it's not retrofitted? Are you seeing, you know, is the market catching? I'll bring you back later on that question, but just wanted to give you a heads up about the question that might come. Let me come back to the sort of general question of financing, because we know the private sector will ultimately have to finance the vast majority of this. I think the Scottish Government has estimated the overall cost being 36 billion, with I would guess the vast majority of that coming in some form from the private sector. I just wondered if you had thoughts on how, if you've seen any examples of good joint working between public sector, private sector, or do you think there's still a bit of work to be done there? And what role could perhaps the Scottish National Investment Bank play in this area as a catalyst, you know, as a bridge between public sector and private sector financing? Fiona, it's a wide topic, so I'll welcome your thoughts on any particular aspect.
Okay. I think the cost issue to start with before we move on to the financing. The costs are substantial, and I think we need to recognise that the costs that we're talking about sit on top of the already very significant inflationary costs that you'll have picked up on, certainly over recent weeks, in terms of supply chains, etc. The Scottish Government's recent consultation on Section 6 on energy standards suggested that there would be a 3-6% uplift in costs as a result of moving to the proposed changes. We estimate that figure is actually closer to 15%, and that's on top of things. For example, the price of insulation is up about 63% this year so far. And that's costs that are provided directly from our members who are building at the moment. So windows up about 30%. So if you're thinking about two of the key factors that you'll be looking in terms of improving the efficiency of your building already, and then the costs of something like moving to a non-gas heat solution. Recent work carried out by SFHA estimated that it was about £2,000 to £5,000 more than a default kind of gas boiler and solar PV panel, you know, per home that you're building. So the costs really are very, very significant in this. And in terms of the financing, yeah, you're right. Ultimately, somebody has to pay for that. And I think what's quite interesting is the role of the customer. As Tom mentioned, obviously, his customers are the tenants who are paying rent. And I'll let him talk about that side in more detail. But the customer side, from a home buyer perspective, the operational efficiencies that you might save over the lifetime of owning a home, as individuals, I don't think we fully look at that in terms of making an increased capital cost decision at the time of purchase of the property. So, for example, if I'm not saying it's 10,000, but if, say, we said it's an extra £10,000 per home is the capital cost of this, do you as a home buyer value that extra £10,000? And the answer is, I don't think we do at the moment. And I think there's a huge raft of work that needs to be done around about customer and public readiness and awareness for this. You mentioned the role of local authority, local government or sort of government in this. It's an interesting some research carried out by CIH last year for Housing Day. It estimated that about 40% of the people who were surveyed would like to move into an energy efficient home. Interestingly, 82% of those people thought that Scottish Government should support landlords or homeowners to meet those standards, and 34% thought that Scottish Government should cover the entire cost of that. So I think there's a huge public awareness issue that we need to deal with in terms of the financing and cost of this. In terms of some of the other solutions of it, we think that one of the things that could be looked at would be looking at LBTT. And is there some way of incentivising the purchase of more energy efficient homes, and LBTT could be one way of doing that. We know there's been a significant shift to the take up of hybrid and electric cars, and in a large part that was driven through changes to company car taxation, which had a lower company car tax rate for electric vehicles. So we can see that changing consumer behaviour in that way has led then to a bigger shift. So I think we need to start looking at some issues around that. So rather necessarily being financial grant contributions towards the cost of it, how can we incentivise consumers to make those financial choices?
Absolutely. Thanks very much for a number of good points there. I mean, in a sense, you almost want, instead of perhaps homeowners getting a new kitchen or conservatory, maybe if we can get the message out there, the best way to add value to your house is to retrofit and decarbonise. Mm-hmm. Very quick, brief supplemental. Those were extraordinary numbers, 63% increase in insulation cost, windows up about 30. I know timber's up as well.
Yeah.
I mean, in reality, does that mean house prices will automatically have to go up because they're all material? So the price will have to be passed on.
Yeah, that's at the minute. That's just a simple, you know, matter of fact. And those costs that I'm talking about are not dealing with net zero.
Yeah.
They are costs of building our homes as they are built today. And then we estimate then that on top of that, then a further approximately 10 to 15% to deal with the transition to net zero aspect of it. So we're talking about very, very significant cost impacts. I think if we'd had the 10 to 15% without the very rapid cost inflation that we've seen over the last sort of, you know, 12 months or so, it might have been slightly easier to integrate, but it's a further addition on top of that, and I don't think customers are ready for it.
Yeah, no, those numbers are quite remarkable. Mm-hmm. Tom, if I'd like to bring you in on the question of finance, please.
Of course, yeah. So I think we've seen a number of key initiatives that we've taken forward, and every single thing we've done has been in partnership with others. So we were an early investor in SunAmp, the battery and thermal storage maker, and we're partnering with SunAmp in a number of different areas to help, you know, with PV and a battery that does hot water for our customers. And we've found we have to take this partnership approach, and a lot of the things that we're trying out are grant funded as well. I think what we're finding, however, is because a lot of this stuff is early, that even people we're pulling in and partnering with sometimes are getting into trouble as a result of it being new and unseen cost and all the rest of it. One partner of ours went bust relatively recently in one of our schemes. So I think that we're at that stage in the market where there's going to be risk, and there's going to be more risk than there would otherwise be. I'll pull out one example that we've used in Midlothian, which is our heat share project. So we partnered with SunAmp and the Green Economy Fund from SP Energy Networks. Now, this was an example of an older person's development, so over 55s, and we put in a mini district heat system. Now, it wasn't fully decarbonised because we couldn't, at that point in that area, at that development, find a way that would fully decarbonise and wouldn't put up the costs for the customer. So we've put in thermal storage, we've put in PV, and at the same time there is a fallback of gas. Now that's effectively an interim position that we will move to a sustainable solution, you know, when we can. But what we've seen from our customer's point of view, there was a fair bit of disruption, you know, more radiators required, so it was quite an intrusive upgrade. However, the feedback is the bills are down, they're able to heat their homes affordably, and the experience now it's all in has been very good. Now that's just one example where we've said, well, we can't at this moment in this area do everything, so we'll move to a halfway house. And I think for us, that future-proofing as we move forward is really critical. So we'll do what we can when we can, and then if that, and we'll future-proof it to allow us to move forward. So I think the need for grant and funding for people to be able to test things out is really, really important. And if you go out and drive through Craigmillar, you'll see there's solar panels on a lot of the roofs. That will 99% of those will be as a result of investment that either we've put in or we've used Scottish Government funding or we've partnered. Now, we find that for the cost of living for our customers, that solar and battery is actually really quite good. So I was with one of our customers a few weeks ago who'd had the battery put in and the solar put on, and I asked her what had happened to her bills, and she said, oh, I just pay the exact same as I've always paid. Now, okay, we didn't in that case reduce bills, but bills have gone up, you know, extortionately over that time period, and we've insulated her from those price rises because of the storage and the battery storage and the PV. We will then move to fully decarbonised for her when we can. But I think part of the challenge we're finding, and I'll get a little bit technical on this, I'm afraid, but when I'm sitting down with our technical teams, we have a patchwork of properties, some of which the spades are going in the ground at the moment, through to things which are 100 years old. And that means that our approach across our stock across Scotland has to be different. And we're finding that as we're doing our visits to look at, right, what can we do at this scheme, we need a more creative approach to how we deal with it. We can't just say, we put in a heat pump, that does the job. It could be a ground source, it could be a ground source that links to district, it could be all sorts of things. So I think the creativity needed to answer the question to fully decarbonise is one of the keys. The one size fits all solution for us and for my team, that's just not feasible because of the stock that we've got. Granted, for new build, that could be quite different. So I think that from a business financing point of view, we are investing more in properties across all of our UK stock. In Scotland, it's up 20%. We're also adding in, we're seeing the cost of our repairs and the numbers of repairs going up, so customer expectations are rising, quite rightly, because they want more from us. And I'm comfortable with that approach, that we're spending more money in customers' homes, making them better. However, the additional cost increases we're seeing, inflationary costs, staffing challenges, and everything that kind of pulls through, is meaning that we're now finding that there is a finite amount of capital available. And we've got, at the moment, SHQS, there's LD2 that's just been done, that we've just completed. We've got, of course, Net Zero. We've got EASH2. And the kind of list goes on of different requirements of investment needs that that we need to put into our properties. And again, I agree that it's the right thing to do. The point is that we only have a finite amount of capital to invest, and we need to make choices about a new kitchen, a bathroom, a heat pump. So I think that the funding piece from government is probably the key to unlocking this. I think when we're looking at pulling in from the government fund for investing in, you know, the net zero heat sources, what we're seeing is that effectively the grant will cover off the additional cost it would we would have, generally speaking, as a rule, the additional cost we would have if we were just to put a gas boiler in. So the incentive there is, well, it's the right thing to do, so we should be doing it. Of course it is. But if we really need a change in the market and we really want to see this complete move away, then a little bit like the point about EV cars and company car schemes, how we incentivise people and businesses to go, it would be madness not to do this. And it would be madness not for us not to put in a heat pump or to decarbonise at this point. And I think that's the key. So, you know, we're very comfortable that we need to invest in our properties, and we will do for the future, and we need to decarbonise them. But I think if we look wider, you know, to really get that uptake, there needs to be the right incentive scheme for individuals and for businesses as well. I mean, we will continue to innovate, and we'll continue to test things out, and sometimes it may not work in the way we want it to, but that's all part of this learning curve, and we want to be at the forefront of it. Yeah. I think on new build, sorry, I'll wrap this up, on the new build piece, the grant is very, very welcome, and it's very helpful. But again, it's similar to the point about retrofit. If we turn the dial on that, I think we will see quite a big change quite quickly as the market goes, it's in our interests and it's obviously the right financial thing to do to decarbonise and to go net zero now.
Fantastic, Tom. Thanks very much. I know a number of my colleagues want to follow up on a number of the points you made. Neil, I guess there's a different dynamic in the commercial sector because am I right in thinking the expectation is that perhaps there's not as much money will come from the public sector to retrofit and decarbonise commercial buildings? I mean, do you cover SMEs, small companies as well? Because I imagine for some of the smaller companies that would be a big issue. What are the sort of like trends in financing you're seeing in the commercial sector?
It's not an area that I'm involved in directly,
right.
But you know, I think I take on board some of the points that have been raised, particularly by Fiona on you know, the value of property. And almost going back to the question that you'd raised before, if you don't mind, I could answer that question.
Yeah.
So there's always been a bit of an issue with making that investment in a sustainable property, and actually you are the developer, but the tenant is the person that benefits through lower utility bills. That historically has been an issue. JLL did a fantastic piece, a research paper called Sustainability and Value in the Regions. And for one of the first times, we found, identified a link between making that investment in sustainability and ESG and creating a, you know, an additional value to the commercial property. So what we identified was that properties that had environmental certification schemes such as BREEAM, where you know, they commanded higher rents over a period of time and they suffered less voids from tenants. The other interesting piece was that we found that the less sustainable buildings are more liable to the prospect of what we call a brown discount, so that they're going to lose value quicker because they haven't been future-proofed. So we think that's a compelling argument, you know, to invest in sustainable property, and it's very much a trend that we're now seeing. You know, over the past year, 18 months, there's been a huge move towards that sector.
And would that be, if, in sort of layman's terms, would that be office buildings, warehouses, or are you looking at manufacturing premises? Just to get a sense of what type of building you're looking at.
We cover a range of sectors, but offices tend to be the main sector that, you know, you can see these they are the shiny buildings that everybody can relate to, and a lot of the net zero carbon research has gone into office buildings. So the likes of the UK Green Building Council has set some of their net zero targets based on office buildings, which are hugely challenging targets relative to where we are just now. So it is a case of not just seeing this building is decarbonised, it's looking at, you know, the energy efficiency of the buildings.
Yeah.
And it's probably a case of bringing the average energy usage of a property or energy usage intensity down by about 60% from where we're at just now. So it's not just a case of let's strip out, you know, during a retrofit, for example, let's strip out the gas boilers and we'll put in heat pumps. You also need to look at the wider, you know, insulation, efficiency, lighting, etc., you know, to reduce that energy consumption.
Great. Thanks very much, Neil. Let me bring in some of the other members. I know they want to follow up in this area. I think Mark Ruskell, who's joining us online, has a supplemental. Mark, I'll bring you in at this stage.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I just wanted to just query a point that Fiona made. I think you said, Fiona, that costs had gone up. You know, well, the estimate of costs from government was that costs were going to go up about 6% for renewables and insulation. And you said, in reality, they've gone up 15%. Is that across all building materials and services, or are you actually picking out the renewables and the insulation and other retrofitting materials as having gone up proportionally more than everything else? Or is this just an uplift in building costs more generally that you're talking about?
Okay, so there's a couple of different things. So the 3-6% figure, that came from supplementary papers that the Scottish Government had prepared in support of the Section 6 consultation. And in those papers, the evidence suggested that the additional costs... Let's forget about any inflationary costs that we have at the minute. So just assuming we were as we were in 2020, the Scottish Government consultation suggested that there would be an additional 3 to 6% cost in terms of delivering the transition to net zero. Our members looked at what was going to be required under the Section 6 consultation and suggested that it wouldn't be a 3 to 6% uplift, it would be a 10 to 15% uplift, simply just in terms of delivering the net zero requirements. The other costs then that I've talked about, the insulation, the windows, that's something that has happened since then. So that's not been taken into account. So the insulation, for example, that's just been since the beginning of this year. From then to end of June, it's estimated 63%. So none of that was taken into account when the consultation was carried out on the Section 6 work back in 2020.
I guess from the householder's point of view, the other thing that wasn't taken into account was the cost of energy, though, which has obviously gone up substantially. Yeah. But the savings would be substantial, wouldn't they? If you're buying a new house that's at a higher standard, you're thinking, phew, I'm not going to have bills of thousands of pounds. It's going to be substantially less than that if I've got PV.
Yeah.
On the roof and a battery.
Yeah, it should be. Also recognising, though, that what we're talking about is the electrification of heat. So we're moving on to... So although you may be using less, at the minute we're moving on to a form of heating that is more expensive to run, albeit you're running less off it. So you begin to get some of those benefits in the short and longer term, but it's still this dilemma between your upfront capital cost and making the connection between that initial upfront capital cost and making savings over the next 10, 15 years. And I think as individuals, the public hasn't fully made those connections. I think we're starting to make the connections, and there's no doubt that over the course of the last few months we're probably starting to make those connections that little bit quicker, but I'm not sure that we've made them as quickly and on the scale that we need to really deliver the whole scale transformation that we're talking about in the timescales that we need.
Okay, back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mark. Next up is Liam Kerr. Over to you, Liam, please.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I'll direct several questions, but just to specific people, if I may. Fiona, just on that point you've just made and in an answer to the Convener earlier, the Scottish Government puts a cost of £33 billion on decarbonising heating in its heat and building strategy. From what I'm hearing from you so far this morning, that figure may already be out of date. Do you think that's a fair conclusion?
Yes and no. It probably is, but I don't have the facts in front of me that would aggregate up to that. But what I can say is that certainly the initial estimates in terms of the Section 6 consultation are significantly less than what we think the reality is. And that's simply just for the new build. And I think it's the timing has been unfortunate, I think, in terms obviously of the wider issues associated with Ukraine, etc., and the wider cost inflationary issues. So I think all of these things are just combining at the minute, and that would make those figures, in my view, likely to be unrealistic at this point.
Thank you. Tom, on the point you made to the Convener earlier, do you think that there is adequate funding for social landlords to meet retrofitting costs, to meet EASH2, to meet the EPCB rating? And if not, where do you think it's realistic to get that funding from? Is that going to come from central government? Is that going to come from local authorities? Or do you need to leverage private finance?
So I think that it depends on the social landlord is the honest answer. So because the stock that each social landlord is having to deal with is so different, if you like, the challenges and the needs and the cost will differ by organisation. Talking from a Places for People Scotland perspective, we're one of the bigger organisations. So I think that I'm pretty confident that with the current government decarbonisation fund and approach, plus the finance that we would invest into our stock, that we can manage the different challenges that we've got. You know, like I said, EASH2, SHQS, net zero. I think that where my fear would be is that I don't think every social landlord across Scotland necessarily has the access to capital that the bigger organisations have. So the questions for me would be, when you've got some really ageing stock and you've got significant numbers in terms of your investment required, how are you going to balance all of that off? Now, if I give you an example of some of the stock that we have in the city centre of Edinburgh, you know, it is, we've got, you know, an older person's over 55's development on the Royal Mile. We've got flats and apartments that are sitting, you know, as social rent flats that if you sold on the open market would sell for £500,000 or above. So our asset base is very strong. Now, we and I strongly believe that mixed tenure, having communities that are mixed, and your tenure is irrelevant in terms of your social standing and stigma, all of that kind of stuff, that it's absolutely right that we have those apartments available for social rent in the city centre of Edinburgh, 100%. However, they're assets that we're sitting on, and they're worth a significant amount of money. And if we were in a position that we had to choose, you could quite easily end up in a situation that you would need to sell some assets to invest in others. Now, we're not in that position, to be clear, and I don't think we will be. But for other organisations, there might come a challenge that they have to sit there and say, it's not affordable for us to decarbonise, you know, some tenement blocks. How can we financially make it work? So the answers are either government funding, additional finance, or they need to find ways to finance it themselves, which might mean selling those and acquiring properties elsewhere, which I don't think can be the answer. You know, for any social landlord to be having to sell properties because of the financial situation and the investment they need, it's just not tenable. So how we avoid that, I think, is probably one of the absolute keys for it. As Place of People Scotland, will have a mixture of finance options available, and we will pull in what's necessary. We're fortunate in as much as we've got a large UK group that will support us when we need to, when they need to, and that gives us capacity and gives us options, and means we've got the ability to pull in lots of different initiatives to help with this situation. So I think that it's a really difficult one, and I think for each social landlord the answer will be slightly different and slightly more nuanced.
Thank you. Neil, I'd like to ask you a question. The Scottish Government is proposing regulations requiring new homes to use zero emission heating systems from 2024. Do you think that that's realistic, both in terms of the cost but also in terms of the skills and supply chains that are going to be required to install and maintain that?
Yeah, as I said before, it's not my area of specific experience. However, I am going through a self-build process at present myself, so it's quite close to my heart. So my own opinion, as somebody who's dealing with retrofit on commercial property, is that it would be foolish to not, you know, to the point that was made by Tom before, it would be foolish to not decarbonise buildings that are new builds. I couldn't see the sense in installing, you know, gas boilers to a new build, particularly, you know, in the timescale of the 2024. I fully appreciate it's going to be challenging. I think if you speak to plumbers on a kind of anecdotal basis, they have certain qualifications that allows them to be a gas boiler or an oil boiler. A gas plumber or an engineer. The same for oil, and it's a separate accreditation for the installation of heat pumps. And I think it's a combination probably of plumbing and electrical expertise that's required for installation of heat pumps. But from my point of view, it wouldn't make sense to me to not proceed on that basis.
Mm-hmm. Fiona, what do you think on that? From 2024, zero emission heating systems, is that realistic from a cost perspective, but also in terms of the skills and supply chains?
In a simple answer, no, I don't think it is. The intention is correct, and I agree that we should be very clearly moving in that direction. However, if we look at the overall supply chain readiness, I just don't think we're there. I think it's important to note that So many of these supply chains will work UK-wide. So the majority of homes that are built in the UK are built in England. They're not built in Scotland. So a significant amount of the supply chains will be geared up to delivering the volume that's needed for their volume customers, which is in England. And their timescales are slightly longer than Scotland. So simple commercial realities, I think, of many businesses in the supply chain, is that they will probably be more focused on delivering the whole-scale changes that will be required for the bulk of their customers, which will be in England, a little bit later than what we're talking about in Scotland. So I don't think that the supply chain in Scotland is fully ready for the challenges to come substantially ahead of what might be required in England. I'm not saying that we need to push back years, but I think there needs to be just a little bit more realism in terms of when actually this can be delivered. As I said at the outset, the physical building of the house is kind of the easy part of it. If we haven't got the supply chain and the skills leading up to that. And I think the other issue is the grid capacity. We're being advised by members at the minute that already in certain parts of the country, they're unable to get large-scale connections onto the grid, that there's insufficient infrastructure there to accommodate that. And if we move to a significant electrification of heat, plus the installation of EV charging points, for example, we're already being advised by many of the DNOs that there simply isn't the grid capacity at the minute. Now, that's not to say that the investment isn't happening and that this is taking place, but I think it's the pace at which it's taking place. What we're suggesting, I think, is that we need a much more joined-up route map to the delivery of the 2024 and targets and beyond. And we've been asking to try and engage with Scottish Government to help us work with the broader industry and supply chain to get that route map. So what we are getting is a date that is realistically deliverable, as opposed to a date that we would like to get to but might not be deliverable.
I'm very grateful to you all. No further questions, Convener.
Great, Liam. Thank you very much. Next up, we have Monica Lennon. Monica, let me hand over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to our panel. There's been some interesting points made this morning about future-proofing, and that takes me back to some evidence we heard back in May from the Existing Homes Alliance. And there was a view expressed that there was a frustration that homes that we're building right now perhaps are not fit for purpose. And Theresa Bray of the Existing Homes Alliance said, "The fact that we are building new homes that will have to be retrofitted is appalling. No one who moves into a new build home should have to retrofit their home. That should be built into the price." And we've heard today about some of the challenges there, and points have been well made. In terms of that view and that desire to future-proof or to get it right now, How do we navigate that? I think Tom has made a few points about more joined up working, and Fiona's talked about a need for a route map. One of the questions that I have is this idea that homes are not fit for purpose, the ones that we're building today. Is this in relation to insulation? Is it about the heating systems? Is it both? And what can we do to improve this situation? Maybe start with Fiona.
Okay, I think I'd like to challenge that view that we're not building homes that are fit for purpose at the minute. I mean, that's just simply not true. We know that already the operational emissions from our homes are around about 75% less than they were back in say 1990. So huge strides have been made in recent years. And what we're talking about now is the final tipping point to getting them to net zero. So it's not that they're not fit for purpose. It's not that they haven't been challenging. There's been continual improvement in the build standards and in the quality that we've got. The changes that will come into the building regulations in October this year, the Section 6 changes, again, will take us to that next bit. And then it's that final tipping point. And I think it's important that we keep that in context of that final tipping point for the new build. is such a tiny, tiny proportion of our overall carbon emissions from our homes, the majority of which comes from our existing stock. So whilst, yes, we need to keep addressing that we're not adding to the problem, the bit that's being added, as it were, is of such a small, small amount compared to where the bulk of the problem lies, which is a retrofit of the existing stock. So it's there, it's a journey. It's not, if it was as easy as saying, yes, we should build it all today, immediately, then we would. But it's not quite ready for that yet, but we're almost there. And there's significant, so a large amount of work that is going into existing new build homes, for example, whether it's insulation, etc., is already taking us very far along that journey. So any retrofit that would be required would be much, much more minimal than something that was even built 5 or 10 years ago.
Thank you, Fiona. And before I move on to Tom, just wanted to pick up the point about building warrants, because we've had some discussion about that too. I wondered, from a Homes for Scotland perspective, Fiona, if you can say, does the current process of building standards verification and the issuing of a building warrant adequately assess the energy efficiency and general standard of the property? We've had some questions about assessing the quality of work to ensure that the energy efficiency measures have been adequately fitted. Do you have a view on that?
Well, I think our view is that the standards are set by government, and the homes are built to those standards. And I said, as those standards are improving, the build techniques are improving to keep up with it. One of the points that I will make is, though, with regards to the skills, both in building control and in planning departments, I think, as I touched on at the outset, what we're now expecting to be delivered by the home builder and then verified by the local authorities, it's a very different skill set than we have currently. And I think the upskilling and resourcing of the local authority, both planning and building control, will really be essential in the future. I think, for example, the NPF4 is indicating that there's a requirement for large developments to have a whole life carbon sort of assessment that's looking not just at the operational but at the whole life. But building control, for example, through the building standards at the minute is still only looking at operational carbon, simply because we don't have the skills and understanding at the moment to look at the whole life. So if we are moving to whole life at some point in the future, do we have the skills in planning departments who may require this assessment? Is that skill sitting in a planning department to assess the information that's being provided to them? And it's not a slight on local authorities, it's simply the reality of the pace at which things are changing. The whole system needs to be upskilled. What we don't want is to find any further blockages that's stopping us from delivering the homes that we still need, because I think it's important to talk, when we're talking about the improvements, we still need to remember that Scotland needs to be delivering around about 25,000 new homes a year. And we estimate that there's a backlog of around about 100,000 homes that should have been built in Scotland since around about 2007 that haven't been built. So if we're continuing to add more pressure onto what's needing to be delivered, is the rest of the system still working to make sure that we can keep delivering at the same time? And how do we reconcile that?
Thank you, Fiona. And you mentioned NPF4, which is still a live issue for the Parliament. It's under scrutiny. So you touched on that need for better alignment between planning and building standards. And Tom, you've talked about a need for a more joined-up approach. Do you want to add to anything that Fiona has said?
Yeah, I suppose for me, simplicity is the key here. Now, I know it's an incredibly complex landscape here, but trying to get everybody to go in one direction so everything lines up, you know, through from inception of project through to a customer moving into a new home, I think that's the key, that it all lines up. And I think what we're hearing, or what I'm hearing today, and I think what I'm hearing from my teams, is that, you know, we do have conflicting policies, and you know, EASH2 and Zero Net are a good example of that. So I think I can't talk in detail about the building standards piece, but I think it feels as though things are slightly fragmented. So if we can find a way, if we all agree that we need to move to net zero, and that's the end point, how does all of the different parts of legislation that we're required to do as a landlord on one hand and then in our development hand on another, how does it all combine and line up into one way of doing things? And then that will give us the long-term stability and clarity of what's required. Because I think some of the challenges we're seeing in terms of, you know, you mentioned why haven't people moved to zero net, net zero full stop for new developments. Well, there is fear that things are going to change, and that, you know, there's, within my organisation, we talk a lot about not doing something and then regretting it later because we have to go back. We want to do it once and we want to do it right. So I think that piece around how do we, because I support what Fiona's saying about this fit for purpose challenge, there's some fabulous developments that are out there. There's some great mixed tenure, and people are, you know, there's a load of placemaking going on. But I hear the challenge that just says, well, why not? And I think that's part of the problem that we've got, is that people will be a little bit fearful of it. If you look at some of our developments, we've got Torna Grain in Highland, we've got Chapelton up in Aberdeenshire, and I think if you look at the way those big developments of ours have moved forward, you can see how early phases or earlier phases will not be zero net and will require retrofit, but the stuff we're doing now that's coming online is starting to be all about net zero. So I think it's a timescale thing as well, that it's just taken a bit of time, because, you know, a project can go from inception to delivery, it can take 3 or 4 years, and I think that's part of the reflection of it feels like there's a lag, and that's more of a nature of the situation we're in.
Thank you, Tom. And the committee, we've been enjoying getting out of the Parliament to see some of the good and innovative practice that exists across Scotland. Neil, I don't know if you want to add to that.
Yeah, just as a chartered building surveyor myself, I think I would echo what Fiona had said regarding the quality of housing being constructed. I think the Scottish technical standards of the building regulations dictate that buildings are being constructed to a high standard. So a home that's built now will be built to a far higher standard than it would have been, say, 20 years ago. What strikes me is if the skills shortage and materials shortage is causing an issue with installation of heat pumps, for example, the technical piece on heat pumps, I'm not an expert on it, but I have installed it, I've retrofitted it into my previous home. Essentially, your boiler becomes redundant or can be retained as a backup. But what you do need to do is increase the size of your radiators, because your heat pump operates at a lower temperature. So I just wonder if there might be some opportunities to think about that retrofit piece to make it as easy as possible, whether that's going to be 10 years down the line or 15 years down the line when your gas boiler becomes inefficient. Because it doesn't make a lot of sense from an embodied carbon perspective to put all that effort and investment into installing equipment that's, you know, essentially going to be redundant in due course.
Thank you. We've had a written submission, helpfully, from Homes for Scotland. It touches on some of the skills challenges within local government. And we've heard in the inquiry quite a lot about the planning workforce within local authorities. There's been a 20% reduction from 2011 to 2020. We've not heard as much about other professions that work within local government. So from a RICS perspective or a surveying perspective, do you have any comments to make about the building standards workforce within local government? Is that an area that's also presenting challenges?
Yeah, I think there's over recent years there has been a reduction from what I've seen in the number of building control officers and other challenges with planning officers, and there's been redundancies in the past in certain local authorities. I think it depends, you know, across local authorities on how much resource is available at a given time. I would imagine in larger city centres there could be some challenges that can cause delays. From a practical perspective, we often are working for commercial clients who are looking to, say, fit out an office so that they can start their business or relocate following, you know, a move at the end of a lease. So the timescale for coming back on a building warrant application and having it validated is very important to the overall programme of delivery. And the consequences of not getting a building warrant approved in time is that you don't get into your, you know, your contractor can't be appointed and then you can't finish the project on time. So it is very important, I think, that the Scottish Government and local government continues to try and invest and recruit for these important positions. I think from a planning perspective, I just wanted to maybe point out that there's a huge lack of what we would class as net zero carbon buildings in Scotland in the commercial sector. My firm had a look around Glasgow last year and there was only two properties that met the net zero targets that have been set out by UKGBC and other bodies. And in Edinburgh, I think the last major development or a development that's being completed at the moment is the Haymarket, and that has taken on board, you know, very good sustainable practice, but that's been pre-let. It's 390,000 square foot, which has been pre-let in Edinburgh, and I think that the next property that's going to be available in the city centre is 2024. So we've got this demand from our sector for sustainable buildings, but there's not really the supply there to fulfil that demand at the moment. So we appreciate that retrofit will have to try and fill that gap. I think the stat that's used widely is 80% of buildings that will exist in 2050 are already built. So you can see the challenge that we have to retrofit as many existing buildings as possible without affecting the character of our towns and cities.
Thank you, Neil. Before I pass back to the convener, because I'm just conscious of the time other colleagues have questions, it's been really good to get your sort of commercial insight, I think, as well, on the panel today. You've just given us some examples there, I suppose, of the lack of sustainable buildings in the commercial side. That's in Scotland. You must work in your company with colleagues across the UK. How does that compare to other parts of the UK?
Yeah, I think what we've found actually is the net zero carbon standards have actually been led by industry. So we've been finding our feet, if you like, on what these targets should be, but ultimately trying to dramatically reduce energy usage. Whole life carbon has been mentioned. You know, we're looking at operational carbon, but embodied carbon is the piece that's very much resonating with our clients. You know, they want to know where materials are coming from. They want to know their overall footprint. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, that's another skills challenge that we're all kind of stepping up to just now. But across the UK, I think the same problem exists as the truth.
Yeah, so very challenging. That's really helpful. Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Monica. And Neil, if you've got any of those research papers that are publicly available, it would be great if you could share them with the committee.
Absolutely.
Sounds like there's some really interesting data you've uncovered. Great. OK, so next up, Natalie Dawn, who's joining us online. Natalie, I'll pass over to you, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. We've chatted this morning about the impact on citizens in terms of cost and disruption. And now evidence suggests that people are more motivated than ever to make changes to their lifestyle to transition towards a net zero. And I think the statistic that I heard this morning was that 40% would like to move into a more energy efficient home. So I'd just like to ask what pressure you feel that there is from customers for more energy efficient homes. And do you feel it's currently a defining factor in choice when purchasing a new home? Sorry, I'll go to Fiona first, please.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, you're right. So the research I'm referring to is work that was carried out in 2021 for Housing Day. So yeah, 40% would like to move into a more energy efficient home, but interestingly, only 14% had made the decision, had considered energy efficiency when making their their last house purchase decision or their last house move decision. So 40% would like to, but in reality only 14% had. So I think there is a momentum towards it. I think it's simply a reflection of society as a whole. We're all much more aware of this. I think where the reality will bite, though, still comes down to cost. That making a home purchase is a very costly decision. And at the minute, if, for example, you're buying a brand new house that's sold, say, for £250,000, and 10,000 of that might be made up from the new net zero piece of it. If you're comparing that to a house that's five doors down, that's exactly the same size house, but maybe is 10 years old and is selling at £240,000, for example, but it's got significantly less operational efficiency. So as a customer, you might want to make that right decision. You might want to buy the newer build property that has more operational efficiencies. But when it comes to it, if it's £10,000 more because you've had to add on those capital costs, will you as a customer make that decision? And that's the dilemma that people are finding at the minute, that it's an expensive decision for people to make. And yes, you may be making those savings over the longer term, but has our mindset moved round to that what do we as individuals, what decisions do we need to make to address our individual role in tackling the climate crisis? And I'm not sure that we're all as individuals ready for that just yet. I refer back to, as I mentioned, something like LBTT then as an example, where you could use some form of fiscal incentive to make that decision more financially attractive for a home purchaser to help them do the right thing.
So following on from that then, do you think that energy efficiency there is being promoted to people in terms of when they're purchasing homes? Yeah. So like, do you feel that those buying and renting properties do have that adequate information to judge the efficiency of their new homes?
Sorry,
just following on from that while I've got this train of thought, do you feel that consumers are adequately informed and protected? So, for example, my colleague Monica Lennon referred to homes being built right now which are not retrofitted. So are buyers aware that there will be that further work required in the future?
Yeah, so I think there's a bit of kind of chicken and egg about that. I think the consumers are being informed of the energy efficiency of their new home purchase. I can only talk about new homes, not about existing housing stock, but if you're buying a new home and that's just being built, you will have a full information pack with regards to your property, you know, what's in it, what's required. During the course of this year, there'll be the introduction of a new consumer code and an ombudsman that will affect the new build house sector. And again, that provides additional requirements for further information to be provided about the ongoing upkeep and maintenance of every new home that's purchased. Again, only for new build. So I think if you're buying a new build home, you will be very informed as to what you're buying, the operational cost. If you're buying an existing property that's not new build, I think as a consumer you probably have some information, but maybe not as much as you might like. Obviously, the EPC information will be available, but that doesn't give you the whole story about the overall efficiency of your home.
Thank you. I'm just going to come back to you again just on that point. Because I know we've kind of talked about that incentivising and giving people more information. In terms of those incentives, I you've said that people that are buying brand new homes will be fairly informed. But for those in current properties that will require work, in terms of that sort of information campaign, we've chatted about sort of the need to maybe show people potential long-term savings or refer them to their house value that might decrease over time if they've not had this work done. Is there anything else that you feel should be involved in that information campaign?
No, I think that would be very welcome. I think anything that informs anything that will educate customers sooner rather than later, because I think as a society we talk a lot at the minute about the changes that industry needs to make and that business needs to make, but obviously it will ultimately all come down to changes that we as individuals need to make. So I think if I were setting out some kind of education and information strategy, I think I'd be very much focused on individuals and what this will mean for you as an individual. So, you know, we're beginning to get this concept that we won't be able to buy our diesel cars in, you know, the next number of years. You know, are we making sure that the customer is aware? Because if you think back to the probably how full your in bag was when in February this year there was the introduction of the new sprinkler systems, and the change, you know, the queries and concerns that you probably had from constituents about, oh, I didn't know this was coming, didn't know how this was going to impact me, how's this going to cost on me, that's going to be nothing compared to what they're going to find out in a few years' time when they find that they can't get a new gas boiler for their house, that they're going to have to get a whole new system put in. And I don't think customers, the public, are simply not aware that these changes are going to be coming down the line. We as an industry are aware because it's our job to be aware of it, and we're planning for it. I don't think the public is.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Apologies, I kind of focused on Fiona there, but I'm not sure if Tom or Neil have anything to add to that. If not, I'm happy to pass back to the convener. Thank you.
Yeah, Tom, over to you.
Just a quick one really from me on this. I think for our social rent tenants in particular, I think as a general rule, it's all about cost of running. So whether it's decarbonised, whether it's gas, whether it's solar, I think, you know, right now, when we're out in communities talking about net zero, would be the wrong conversation for them. It's about how much is it going to cost. And I think if we can find that for tenants and for retro, if we can find that way that we can reduce the cost, then it will be a very easy conversation. Your costs are going to go up even more than they are, which is the thing that as a social landlord that I just, you know, it's a not can't sleep at night kind of thing, isn't it? So that's the piece for my customers, that it's all going to be about running costs, because we take the capital cost in the investment.
No, I appreciate that. Thank you. And I think in terms of moving towards any sort of aspect of a more environmentally friendly life, there is always added cost implications. So it's important to keep that conversation going for people in poverty. I'll pass back to the convener now. Thank you.
OK, Natalie, thank you very much. Next up is Jackie Dunbar. Jackie, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. We hear a lot that to get to net zero, that the public and private sector are going to have to work together. So can I ask you what you think the key challenges are going to be to make it necessary for that partnership to happen? I don't know if that makes sense at all. Neil, can I come to you first? Because that's in the broader sense of commercial land housing, I think.
Well, I'll try and answer it as best I can. I think, generally speaking, we are acting on the commercial side of things. I think from, you know, what had been mentioned before about planning, for example, it might be helpful to engage between the parties, given this lack of net zero carbon buildings that we have on the horizon, you know, to try and work in partnership more, to, you know, where you've got a developer who's interested in, you know, investing in a city or a building and making that redevelopment, you know, they are paying a premium, you know, for that net zero carbon piece, which is over and above the building regulations. So I think it would be helpful if the local authority could understand that and appreciate that investment that's been offered by the developer, and almost work in partnership to try and deliver these types of buildings, and give them, you know, perhaps a bit more time in terms of pre-assessments and that sort of thing, given that that's where we're trying to get to.
And do you think that the distribution network operators are well prepared in regards to what's coming forward?
It's not one for me to answer, but you know, it is one of the first questions that we do ask if we are moving towards a, you know, to decarbonise a building, as you have to look at the capacity of the network and you have to get in touch with the utility provider you know, have that conversation. But you know, you can see pressure coming down the line as we move towards fully electric buildings.
Okay, thank you. Tom, would you like to add anything?
Not on that point, no. I think, could you just repeat your question, sorry?
My first question?
Yeah, the first one, yeah, I was getting mixed up.
It was just to ask what the key challenges you think will be to make sure that the public and private sector work together.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, from our experience, we're doing it. So we will partner with whoever the best people are to get the job done, really. And I think that particularly in Edinburgh, we work closely with the City of Edinburgh Council in various guises. So I think that those relationships are often there. And it's a case of, I think, you know, back to my earlier point about how we try and just line everything up so we're just all facing in the same direction. Because for me, whether it's affordable property that's part of, you know, the part of Places for People Scotland, whether it's, you know, a local authority property, you know, the more affordable housing is the goal that we're aiming for, you know. And I think that that's the key, is that we try and get to a place that it doesn't matter who's doing it, it's the best people for the job. And that will be a combination of public, third sector, and private. And I think that will be the key. And on a project-by-project basis, I think you will see that a lot of that partnership is already happening. It might not be massively visible. And the City of Edinburgh Council just announced a zero net development in Granton a few days ago with CCG. So things are happening. And I think the innovation is there. So for me, it's about more of that and just making sure that policy backs all that up so we're all in the same direction.
So you don't see any sticking points in the future, or?
Oh, I see plenty, yeah. I think the challenge for us, the biggest sticking point is that pace piece about how we can do this quickly. It's ever so important that we decarbonise as quickly as we can and we keep it affordable. But, you know, to the point I made earlier, I've made a few times, the single biggest sticking point for my customers is going to be the cost of heating their homes affordably. And, you know, that's bring it back to that, but that's what we really care about.
Fiona, I'm looking at you. I'm not sure if you'd like to come in.
Yeah, so in our, referring back to our response to the Section 6 consultation last year, we made a proposal to the Scottish Government that we thought there should be some form of joint working group, steering group, call it what you will, that works together to create this route map, and that route map, that steering group should include ourselves, DNOs, supply chain, and within Scottish Government, we think it should include, for example, representatives from the More Homes Division, as well as the Building Standards Division and those dealing with the new build heat standards, because all of these parts of the jigsaw, I think, are all bits that are all, at the minute, from our perspective, it seems there's lots of bits of pieces that are all working in their own bits, but we're not seeing that route map, and it's the route map that we need to get it delivered. Your second point about the DNOs, again, our understanding is that they are working on it, they are investing in it, and are moving in that transition, or moving towards that transition. But it's a huge beast to move and to turn. And I refer back to my point at the beginning that the building of the house is the end part of it, and all the rest of those bits are in line. So, are the DNOs fully ready? I can't speak on their behalf, but from our perspective, we don't think they are as ready as some of the legislative and the intended policy timescales might like them to be. And that's not to say that they're not moving that direction, but I'm not sure that we're all moving at exactly the same pace, that policy is moving at the same pace as the supply chain and the skills. And I think just a little bit more coordination would help get us all to the end point in a much more effective manner.
Okay, thank you. If I can go on to local authorities a little bit, if I could ask you, I think they're getting better at involving the local communities and asking them what they would like to see going forward. With that in mind, how do you think the housing sector could actually help maybe developing us and support the local government reaching out to the folk that will actually be living in the houses in the future?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think certainly through the planning process, there already is quite substantial engagement right from a very early stage in the process. So I think that there is definitely a role for the home builders and local authorities to be working together on it. I think some of the concerns we still have, for example, major housing applications in Scotland, on average it was taking 59 weeks for a decision to be made for major housing applications. That's compared to 16 weeks as a statutory, and major business applications taking about 22 weeks compared to that. So, and even those who have a what's referred to as a processing agreement in place, only 33% of those were having decisions made within an agreed timescale. So it's already a very lengthy and very delayed process in getting these applications through to build houses that people need. So again, back to the investment and the role of local authorities, is we need to be making sure that there's investment and resources in the local authorities to help deliver whatever kind of homes, wherever they're being built. You know, they need that planning system to be working in support of it. And at the minute, it's not certainly not in the effective way that it needs to be.
This is maybe more a question for Tom, but how do you think the local government can bring the local community with them when there is new significant housing building hopefully a way to take place?
I mean, I think we're very connected to our customer base, so we spend a lot of time listening to their concerns, talking to them in the communities, but also polling on a variety of different aspects of what we do. So I think there is, if you think about the 10,000 customers that we've got, there is a very easy access for us when we're working with them, local authorities, to understand need. And I think how that flows out into what we do with new developments. I mentioned some of our newer kind of signature developments at Long Nidry, up at Chapelton, at Torna Grain. The essence of those communities is all, the essence of those developments is all about community. And we have, we take a very sensitive approach to even what the houses look like. So if you go to Long Nidry and then go up to Chapelton, you will see it's completely different. And it's completely different because we're wanting it to fit in with the essence of the community that was either there or in the area. So I think that understanding of local need and what people want, particularly when you get into more rural communities like where I'm from in Perthshire, that you need to talk to those people. You need to understand what they need. So I think that we can quite easily, work with customers and to understand what they want. And I think what we know at the moment is the key things that are sitting. We've talked about cost of living, but the other things that are in customers' minds are quality of home and speed of repair, and unsurprisingly, it's the basics that customers want. They just want to live their best life, do their thing, and not be bothered by their landlord. And I think if we take that as a general rule, that the bits that concern them are the basics, and making sure that they've got the things they need to do that. So when we then move that into new developments, I think local authorities, RSLs, and other partners can quite easily work together. What's interesting is when we have new build coming on in any of our communities, the community know. So they're well aware when there's new build because there's a huge appetite within our communities to get the newer houses, if that makes sense. So there already is a real connection to what's going on in communities. Can more be done? Yeah, I think so. But that's just about us having the ear to the ground and the connection to people. And that's something that, as an organisation, we really focus a lot of time and effort on.
Okay, thank you. I'm conscious of time, convener, so I'll pass back to yourself.
Great, Jackie. Thank you very much. Final questions from Mark Ruskell online. Mark, over to you, please.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'm aware that we're up against time. So if I could ask the panel for some reflections on two issues, please. I mean, one is where you see the role for passive house standards or passive house equivalent standards, what some of the opportunities and challenges might be in that area. And then secondly, just around the EPC certification as well, and where you potentially see opportunities for reform of that process. Can I start with Neil, please?
Yeah, again, it's not my area of expertise, but passive house is certainly an aspiration that I think subject to costs, and I believe that would be a cost premium to go for passive house, and others would be better placed to advise on how realistic that is, you know, on a wider scale. I think it's something that certainly individuals may aspire to, and I would encourage them to do so if that's you know, what they're looking to achieve from their development. On EPC certification, it's certainly an area of debate. What I find from a kind of in the sector that I'm in is that I work for clients that operate across the UK, and the minimum energy efficiency standards that have been introduced in England and Wales are fairly clear on improvements and the kind of roadmap that takes you to EPC B ultimately by 2030. There has been an awful lot of consultation in Scotland from what I have observed, and I think, just, you know, in summary, it would be helpful just to get to the end of that process so that we have clarity and we can give sound advice to our clients.
Okay, thanks. Fiona?
I mean, I think in terms of the passive house or equivalent standards, it's my understanding that by the time we've moved to the standards that will be introduced in Scotland by 2024, and the ban on gas boilers effectively, and the other building regulation changes that are likely to come in at around about that time, that we as industry will be at or almost at those standards. I think it's important again to note, just though, to touch back on the cost again, is that again, setting aside any other inflationary costs at the minute, that a typical two-bedroom house would see roughly 17% additional capital cost from the way the house is built at the moment to moving it to a passive house standards is roughly 17%. And again, that might be something that's acceptable to, as Neil said, to individuals who are wanting to achieve that. But if we're still trying to deliver that in terms of the overall volume of homes that we need in Scotland, I think it'll be a challenge to be delivering that at that pace and scale at that additional cost as well, if we were just to say, right, it's all to go tomorrow. But as I've said already, we are well on the journey towards that, and by the time we come to sort of 2024, 2025, we'll be at or very close to those standards. And the EPC issue, I've got no particular comment on that.
Thanks. And Tom?
Yeah, thank you. On passive, I mean, I think moving to a place where customers don't need to heat their homes is absolutely an ambition, or use as little energy as possible, without doubt. How we get there and whether it's affordable, you know, at the current, you know, at scale at the moment, I think is probably the question. And as an ambition, 100% very much behind it. On EPC, I think that is something that is challenging. So we've been looking up at Tawna Grain about how for the next phase what we do around decarbonisation. And the SunAmp thermal batteries that we have installed elsewhere don't come into the SAP calculator for EPC, which means that for us, it's often absolutely the right thing to do, but it won't impact the EPC, and in fact, it might impact it in a negative way. So that's one of the examples of where having everything lined up, the EPC and net zero has to just go together. It has to be one of the same. And at the moment, I think there are examples where it's not lined up. And it would mean that if we were purely to focus on EPC, we would move to air source rather than necessarily use the battery installs as of right now. So I think that's something that we definitely need. We need to kind of, as a from a policy point of view, we need that to support the end goals. And whether it's battery, whether it's heat pump, all of it is decarbonised. I think that should be reflected in the EPC.
That's interesting. I've had personal experience of EPC in my own house not reflecting batteries, and then having to go to Home Energy Scotland and get a fresh certificate that recognises batteries exist and that they might be a good option. Can I just end then with one question back to yourself, Tom, and that's around the second energy efficiency standard for social housing. And the government's just announced this morning that they're going to bring forward that review for this year of that standard. What would you be looking to come out of that review?
I think for us that we... I'm going to kind of repeat, I think, what I've said, but all of these things just have to line up. They have to line up, and we have to find a way that our customers can heat their homes affordably, and we reduce the requirement for any heat source, because we insulate it, we go fabric first, and then we follow up with appropriate heat source, and we keep that focus on cost. And I think that if we're able to find a way to drive industry to, you know, in one direction, then we'll get to where we need to. So I think the for us, you know, we will of course follow and engage with government throughout any discussion on it. But the simple fact is that we need it to be simple, and we need it to really make sure we have customers and people at the heart of all of the policy. And I think if we do that, then we'll find that we get to the right answer.
Yeah. Thanks very much. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you, Mark. I have one very final brief question for Fiona. You mentioned a couple of times the need for a joined-up route map between local government and national government. The submission paper from Homes for Scotland referred to a national delivery agency to do that. I wasn't sure if that was a reference to the Scottish Government's National Energy Agency, or because that's a virtual agency, as you know, which is not going to be fully operational until 2025. Or was that a reference to that agency, or was that a reference to the need for something more?
I think what we're talking about is just in terms of the the delivery of all homes in Scotland. So regardless of tenure, regardless of location, regardless of their net zero position, I think our view is that at the minute there's insufficient joined upness in the entire system that helps focus on delivering more homes. So something similar to what's happening in England, Homes England, for example, where there is a much more sort of joined up different bits of government funding streams, etc., the release of large-scale public assets for housing development, a lot of that is coming in a much more coordinated manner. So I think that's really what we're suggesting, is that something that helps align all the different parts of the system. I go back to one of my previous points, that we should be building around about 25,000 new homes a year of all tenures in Scotland. We estimate we've got a backlog of around about 100,000 compared to what we were building sort of 2006, 2007. So something that jointly helps us all work in the same direction to be delivering those homes.
Yeah, that would certainly help the committee as well. Thomas, I saw you were nodding along there. Did you want to come in?
I'm in complete agreement. And I think that, you know, our experience of how we're currently structured and set up, that overarching mind, if you like, would be very welcomed.
Great. Well, look, that brings us to the end of our allocated time. Thank you all for joining us. It's been a fantastic session. I think we've covered a wide range of very important points. So thanks for taking time out and being in front of the committee this morning. Enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you. That concludes our public meeting, and we will now move into private session. Thank you.